over the weekend, we had the richest horse race in the world.
Yes.
At the richest race meeting. It was the Dubai World Cup. We thought we'd better find out a bit more about it. So one man who seriously loves a punt has dropped by for a bit of a chat. Please welcome a good friend of the show, Trevor Marmalade. But we're here to talk about horse racing, aren't we? You love a bit of a punt. And there was, how big is the Dubai Cup?
Well, it's the richest racing day or night in the world on the racing calendar. Mm-hmm. And the World Cup itself is worth $10 million US.
Fantastic. What do you get for winning?
Well, the World Cup is $10 million, and it's, the trophy is actually solid 24-carat gold.
Jeez.
Which is a beautiful trophy. And actually, I remember David Hayes telling me a story. David, of course, legendary trainer. His father, Colin, trained for a long time as a Hall of Fame trainer. And David took over from his father about 20 years ago, and they trained a few horses for the Sheikhs back then, but he'd never met the Sheikh. So he thought he was going on a trip overseas. He thought he'd pop by in Dubai and he'd drop off some of the trophies that the horses had won. Oh, so, yeah, nice little excuse to go and visit the Sheikh. Yeah. So he gets led into the Royal Palace, where the 27 bathrooms have solid gold taps and fixtures,
yes,
and the doorknobs are worth about 100 grand each. And he realises that under his arm in his box, he's got about 20 grand worth of trophies.
Yeah, that's...
And he said the Sheikh reached in and he pulled out the Canberra Cup, which then was worth about 500 bucks and might have had some silver in it. And he said, I felt so embarrassed. He said it was like presenting the Queen with a Mickey Mouse watch.
Yeah, that's... when you get the man who got everything.
Copperard, basically.
I do love to go to different race meetings around the world.
All around the world, haven't you?
I'd love to.
The big ones?
Went to, Japan Cup, went to Ascot.
Seymour Cup,
but no, haven't quite made it there yet. But Japan Cup was interesting. We're on the platform waiting for the train to go to Fuchu Racecourse on the big day. Mm-hmm. And there was a guy walking past with a briefcase and we just happened to say, oh, excuse me, mate, is this the right train, the right platform to go to Fuchu? And he looks at us in typical Japanese fashion. He says, I commit to you, I will take you to Fuchu Racecourse. Okay. So he got on the train with us, got off the train, put us on another train, got on that with us, put us on the third train, said, this one will take you to Fuchu Racecourse.
Wow.
And he bowed and the doors shut and we clapped.
And he's here tonight.
And we thought, how fantastic
that is. That is fantastic.
Imagine going to work at about lunchtime and your boss saying, where have you been? Here, right? Well, I saw some Japanese tourists who asked me where Phillip Island was. And I decided to give them a lift. Would your boss say to you, oh, you've done a great honour for your country? Or would he say, pack up your shit, you're out of here?
Have you ever done the big one? The one in Italy, Santo. What's that called?
The Palio.
The Palio. Well, look, we do. I've been to the Palio, but it's great to go to the major race meetings. But I also love when we're away to go to some of the meetings sort of out of the way.
Yeah, yeah.
Like the first time I ever went overseas with my girlfriend, who became my wife, we went to Thailand and we were in Chiang Mai. And I found out there was a race meeting at Chiang Mai that day.
Yeah.
So I thought, oh, well, let's go along. So we went. We got a taxi driver who used to be a jockey, and we said, look, you come in with us for the day and explain what's going on.
You're very good at that, finding locals that are keen on horse racing.
Absolutely. Well, don't worry, we found him. Yeah. And we're thinking, well, what do we do? Like, we're at a race meeting where we don't know the horses, we don't know the form. And I said, that's all right, let's just find the mounting yard, and hopefully there's, like, one horse that's a lot bigger than the rest, and we just bet on that, right?
Yeah.
Now, there's no mounting yard. And I get told the only place to see the horses is when they come out onto the track through the gate.
Okay.
So I'm standing by the gate and looking at number five coming through, going, oh, yeah, pretty plain tight.
Legs.
And the jockey looks down, he goes, number two.
No.
Number two.
I
look at Kerry, I said, I reckon that's not a bad tip. Over there, of course, it's very primitive, as I say, so there's no tote.
No.
Basically, what they had was like a raffle ticket system. So if you wanted to bet number one, you walked up to window number one and they sold you a ticket to the value.
Yeah.
So I go to bet number two and all the windows are shut, right? So the driver comes around and said, I've found a window around the back.
Yeah.
So we go around the back. It's the last window open. It's a denomination of 20,000 baht for a bet, which is about 700 Aussie, right? Now, we got 2 weeks of the holiday left. I've got about 1,500 on me. I'm thinking, ridiculous. To be at a race meeting, don't know the horses, don't know the form, to bet half my bankroll.
Yeah.
So I bet.
Of course.
And, well, you know, and knowing that we're going to be sleeping in flea pits and eating from street carts if it loses.
Yeah.
And, well, they jump for the race and, well, as I see the horse coming, we wait for number two to come out, and it comes out, it's a little grey pony, and it's reefing, it's tearing, it's trying to buck the jockey off, it's foaming from the mouth. Yeah. At Flemington, I'm thinking a bad sign. Here in Chiang Mai, I'm thinking moral. Absolute certainty, right? This horse jumps from the barriers. After they've gone 100 metres, it's 10 lengths in front. I'm thinking, hang on, hope it's got something from the end.
Yeah.
After 200 metres, it's 20 lengths in front.
Yeah.
It's going past the winning post. The rest of the horses are just rounding the home turn, except for one straggler out the back.
Yeah.
So he wins the race easily. And then it's time to pull the horse up. Horse doesn't want a bar of being pulled up. It just wants to keep going. So the jockey's a passenger, and he's coming around the home turn from the second time, and the last horse is still 100 metres from
That's
the winning
fantastic.
Post.
Right?
The crowd starts to cheer. The jockey on the last horse pulls the whip, thinking that he's going to be lapped. The guy on the horse has already won the race, pulls the whip on his in response to the crowd. That's the only time I've seen the jockey on the last horse in the race punch the air in triumph.
On that note, you're never going to beat it, that racing story. That is going to be the best one
ever. Please thank Trevor Marmalade for enlightening us on horse racing. We'll be back with more Sports Fever right after the break. Thanks.